afternoon. My name is not Liz Christensen. My name is Callum Holmtook. I'm a sort of last-minute substitution. I think Liz hurt her ankle yesterday, so I was unable to be here today, so I'm stepping in as facilitating today. But I'm sort of accompanied by sort of Jeanette and Cathy sort of as speaker and scribes. They'll be helping me kind of hopefully gather all your insight into the kind of what it is we want the Scottish Government to do to help older people. So if I'll just quickly introduce how this next hour will run, I'll pass over to Jeanette and then pull back to me, and really it's actually up to yourselves. What will happen is, as you're speaking, so Mary, up there, that you'll see a kind of red light come on your own microphone in front of you. If you can just wait till you see the red light before you start speaking, I'll sort of signal that you're the next speaker, but if you can wait till the red light, that just ensures we can capture everything. Okay, so if that makes sense, great. You all know anyway, but sort of obviously male and female toilets are just out at the sort of the back of the kind of vestibule hall. Men's to the left, women's to the right.
Can I ask you if we're being recorded?
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes. That's why if we can wait for the lights to come on, the microphones, that ensures that it will be recorded. If we don't, it won't be. The microphones won't pick you up. Can everyone hear me? Great. Okay, it's a great room for sort of talking, and the microphones will absolutely help that. So the format for today is, I'm going to pass to Jeanette in a moment. After that, she's going to talk through the sort of the programme and the sort of priorities. And after that, what we want to do is kind of identify our two priority themes areas out of the six that Jeanette's going to speak to in a moment. And after that, after we've identified the two broad areas, what we want to look at is some specific actions and campaigns under that. What is it our priorities under those specific areas? So I'm sure we will get some discussion going about actually what our priorities are. But I will try to keep it. We've got an hour. I'm sure we could spend the rest of the day in here, but I will try to keep us moving along as tightly as possible. There might be times that the scope of this discussion is, if where possible, is going to be on the powers of the Scottish Government. So actually, if where possible, I'm going to try and keep the kind of actions to the competence of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament. So I'm sure there'll be other insights and maybe things that are reserved to Westminster. I absolutely do share that, but I think most of our discussion and conversation should be about things that are devolved competence of the Scottish Parliament. Is that clear? Great. Okay, I'll pass it to Jeanette now.
Hello, everyone. SOPA went round the country and they spoke to older people's groups and they listened and they shared experiences with them. And older people raised their concerns about various things, but SOPA then decided to do a list of what of things that they had heard and from older people. And there's a list here, SOPA's concerns in priority order, and that's the six items. And I think you've all got a copy of them. So the first one was housing and community safety. And it was obviously there's a shortage of houses, for affordable houses. And they also spoke about the lack of safe environments and a limited police presence. That worried a lot of older people. So I'll now go on. I've actually only got 5 minutes to do this, so I'm trying my best to get through all of them. And number two on the list was health and social care. And I don't know if you're aware, there are no older people on these integrated joint boards for the health and social care. And another thing they picked up was loneliness and isolation. Also, discrimination in the health service. And also, another thing that really worried people was end of life, our end of life choices. So number three is transport, travel and environment. And they found there was a lack of transport options to access recreation and culture and various things, especially in the evenings. And as we know, older people need to get out and about and join these things, because it saves them from having, well, most of them, from depression and isolation and loneliness. So number four, community empowerment. And that there's poor opportunities in a lot of areas to get involved in learning and supporting, volunteering. And a lack of inclusiveness, especially LGBT people. Number five is retirement, pensions and money matters. And major concerns about food and fuel payments. Paying the fuel bills is a great worry to lots of older people, and funeral costs, and I think Alec and Sunil touched that this morning. So number six is communication and information, and it's computer use is difficult for some older people. So end-of-life issues also problematic there, obviously communicating that to people. So, have I done that in 5 minutes? I wanted to say, unfortunately today we can't let everyone introduce themselves because there isn't time, but if you could give your name when you come in.
Great. Okay, thanks very much, Jeanette. So that's it. So that's six headlines, and I think the important thing with Jeanette done was she listed them in the order which they've been prioritised already by SOPA, based on the feedback from kind of older people's group in the assembly last year. So there was, you know, housing, community safety, health and social care, transport, travel, environment, community empowerment, retirement, pension and money matters, and communication and information. So that's not just six, that is the order in which they were ranked. So the first thing we really want to do as a group is actually work out what do we collectively think are our two main areas of priority. And I would just kind of like to open that up for any initial comments on what your individual kind of priority areas are before we look at what we want to do under them. Yep, sorry.
Integration of health and social care.
Health and social care, yes. And that echoed anybody else nodding heads, slightly raising hands?
I have a difficulty here because I think that they're all important. I think they're all priorities. And I have a great difficulty in suggesting, in accepting the idea that we have a listing from one to six in terms of all of these issues. Issues affecting older people are complex and multi-agency, and I think, therefore, that it's a bit unrealistic to ask us to prioritise out of an existing priority or priorities. My argument would be that we should look at all of this in a broad way, in a broad manner, you know, and look at it overall.
I think my concern with that, I think you're absolutely right. I think we've got 53 minutes. What I would suggest is if we can, in the first instance, perhaps identify the first two and then the actions under that. And if we have time, we can then sequentially work through the other areas, because I think we could be here all day absolutely and kind of quite enjoyed the debate and discussion around what we need to do. But my concern would be if we spread it out too widely initially, we'll never get down to the specificity. And I think that what we want to, and what we've been tasked with, and what we're absolutely clear, is we need to take back specific actions and calls and campaigns back to the kind of plenary session. So if we can, in the first instance, just agree what those two are, and then if we've got time, we'll continue to look at the other areas and identify the actions from that. Does that sound agreeable?
Nobody's asking, but I'm going to tell you anyway. Transport, travel and environment seems really important to me. And that's just a personal thing,
right,
here. And retirement, pensions and money matters seems important.
Okay.
But I think they're all important. That's what she's trying to say. I think every one of those issues affects us in one way or other, or affects our the people
that's,
we know.
Thank you. Sorry, gentlemen.
I'm John McCallion from the Dundee Pensioners Forum and the Scottish Pensioners Forum. I think it is health and social care as a standout here. I mean, that doesn't mean that any of the other issues are less of a priority. It's just that if we've got to focus on things which are the responsibility of the Scottish Government, then this is the biggest piece, biggest change that they're introducing at the moment, is how they're delivering health and social care for older people. And it's a massive change in the way older people are being treated. And I think we should focus on that. And I'm quite happy whichever one, whichever other issue other people want to see.
Okay. Any other sort of opinion? I think what we'll do, Cathy's suggesting, I dismissed it instantly, but I think she's right. I think what we'll do is we'll a bit more discussion on this, and we'll probably just take a quick vote on what prioritise. But
Ken Harold, National Pensioners Convention, I certainly think that the health and care, social care, is a major issue. It's also a major issue about finance. And just to quote an example, the City of Edinburgh Council, in their recent budget debates, were debating whether they've got enough money for the home care assistance, and they haven't. Now, we can all start blaming who, that's not the point. The point is, they were talking about rationing the home care assistance, which means that it would delay the bed block and increase the bed block and all that. Talking about vetting pensioners that are living at home is an utterly inhumane action.
So I think actually we should probably just go to a kind of quick hands up, unless anyone else wants a comment before we do a quick vote.
I'm a wee bit concerned about the sort of premise that we only deal with matters that devolved to the Scottish Parliament, because one of the big issues is pensioner poverty, and we elect MSPs, and so why shouldn't SOPA campaign to the Scottish MPs and campaign at Westminster on the issue of pensioner poverty and the level of pensions? You know, this organisation is, I thought, looking at all aspects of pensioners' life in Scotland. It might be inconvenient, but the fact of the matter is, reality is, that we would need to talk, SOPA would need to talk to MPs from Scotland and other parts of the UK in terms of pensions.
I think it's a huge issue to rule out. I don't want to rule it out. The brief was more to try and focus our actions around Scottish Parliament, where we'd probably have a little bit more accessibility and success. But absolutely, when we're identifying these themes, when we look at the action, if there's a kind of majority of feeling that actually we want to focus more on money matters and pension activities, then that's absolutely the kind of decision of the group, and we'll run with that. There's no, I don't want to kind of inhibit someone's kind of passion for looking at one area or another. So, this is the last comment, then we are going to take a quick vote on this, because I think we'll go around for ages before we get to having a discussion. Yes.
Prachy Midlothian, this gentleman over here hits a very important point. That is that Edinburgh is struggling for cash. Now, most of you will be aware that Edinburgh is now thinking about paying off 2,000 of their workers. Now, one of the things that has been raised in the past and it's been shut down on many occasions is this business of hotel room tax. Now, we in Edinburgh here have...
Sorry, John. I think that's probably coming into the specificity of what we're calling for, but I think right now we need to just agree on what the themes are. Once we've identified what those themes are, I think we can raise it again, but right now I just want to identify the two of the six. Because that was what I said at the beginning. How we'd split this session?
We're going to spend more time talking about. Well, I think if you'd let me just continue.
If we can take a vote on each of the six in turn, and we'll just have a quick hand count. So the first area is on housing and community safety. And there's any hands for that for the kind of priority area? None. Okay. The second one on health and social care. Okay, that's everyone. And as a second, so transport, travel, environment, community empowerment, retirement, pensions and money matters. Yeah. And communication and information. Okay, I think that's fairly clear. So the two priorities were health, social care, and social care, and then retirement, pensions, and money matters. So I think the overwhelming priority of the, you know, all here was actually around health and social care integration. And obviously, as you all know, the health social care integration will come together really in April next year when the sort of new partnerships are in place. As a lot of you will know, the integration boards are getting populated by kind of professionals and users, and some examples across the country, not many, but some older people are actually having some representation on that group. I know in Stirling, and I believe in Argyll and Bute, and maybe some other partnerships, actually older people are having direct representation on those boards, which will help hopefully direct commissioning decisions on that partnership. So I think that is an important positive progress that's been made to ensure older people's views are being considered. But that will not be enough in itself. So if we could just maybe elicit some kind of thoughts on actually what are the specific asks and campaigns that we want to see under that? What do we want to see? What are we going to call for? Yes.
Well, I'm on the Edinburgh Older People's Joint Management Group, and it, I think, is a sort of subsidiary of the Joint Integration Board, but it's specifically for older people. And there's two lay members on that, but we have no voice. We only can observe and supposed to pass information back to other older people's groups. Now, the thing about that is, I'll just add that my feeling and my other layperson is that there seems to be an awful lot of people. They seem to be asking for every single voluntary sector, everybody you can think of is being asked to submit something, and there's just nothing that integrates the thing properly. There's just too much spread out and no decisions are really taken. But we have actually ideas about older people, but we're not allowed to really.
It's just observer status then,
Edward.
There's
no opportunity. Yes, we have no power or anything to. Well, we can add a comment.
I mean, can I ask then, what are other people's experiences of the boards that are getting set up already? Sorry, John.
Yeah, I can only speak about Dundee, but we met with some of the senior officers in Dundee. And while the integration board's broadly based, the trade unions are on it, and all kinds of people are on it, there's only six voting members. Yeah. Three of them are councillors, and three of them come from the health board. And, of course, that calls into question, what if the vote's 3-3? There's no casting vote for the chair either. That doesn't seem a good recipe from my perspective. Also, the budgets are administered by the Joint Integration Boards, but authority over the budgets remain with the Health Board on one hand and the local authority Social Work Department on the other. So it looks like it's changing dramatically, and it's not really changing dramatically. And remember, the Health Boards are not democratically accountable to anybody except the Minister. And there's only three councillors, and who knows how they're going to vote anyway. So it's a very unsatisfactory way, I think, of setting up. If you want old people's voices, trade unions' voices, give them the vote as well. I mean, that would be my perspective, but I don't think the people in power want ordinary people to be.
So how do you mean, sorry, John, so what, just
if,
to tell
if there's some dispute about how the money's spent, the only people who can vote in it are the councillors and the health boards. Nobody else gets a vote.
Yes, I mean, I think that's certainly, you know, across, when I've looked at the models across the country, while they will have third sector carers, service users, representatives, which absolutely is, you know, to be encouraged, John's absolutely right, I certainly don't know, and I'm sure there is not an example anywhere in the country where they have a voting entitlement. You're allowed to contribute and speak at these meetings and give your insight, but there's no vote on the way decisions spent. And I think the point is, I'm sure the government say that there is that democratic accountability. I know your main point, right? Yeah, well, I mean, accepting the minister. But I guess that's obviously where the government's coming from. I suppose what, even taking a step back from that, I'm not sure, and it'd be interesting to know from other people, are at least all partnerships having at least opportunity for people to speak? You know, it sounds like Edinburgh isn't. And even inviting older people to even speak in this non-voting role. I don't know anybody else's experience about other partnerships that have been developed, because it seems, for me, that seems like an absolute necessary first step. That there's an, I'm sort of leading rather than chairing here, so somebody else should probably talk here. But I'll just put that out there. I'd like to hear your views.
Well, they're originally described as partnerships, and now they're described as joint boards. It's a totally different method of operation, that, isn't it? So the there's a lot in the name and the sort of account, the sort of methods of accountability that will go behind that.
So we just, so there's a feeling there that it needs to be more partnership, just more older people's representation and involvement in the actual board before they actually start.
Oh yeah, you recognise who the partners are, and those partners have a right to take part. Okay. That's not the way it is with a joint board, is it? As somebody said, joint board, you've got several formal members who vote, and the power's all with them. That's not a partnership, is it?
Yeah, so it's yourself and it's just the common theme there is just really about actually older people having a voice that actually, probably more than a voice, actually something, it's power, really. So that, so we've got a kind of waiting towards some, you know, council and health board have voting rights, but we're kind of feeling that there's an absence of power from Jeanette.
Just to say, it's my understanding that there is nothing in the Act, it hasn't been written into the Act or the Bill, that an older person has speaking rights. That hasn't been written into the Bill.
No, I think... I feel like I'm probably leading rather than taking. So I'd like somebody else to try and maybe formulate what it is we're saying here a little bit. Sorry, yes.
Jean Brown and I come from Seniors Together, which is run in conjunction with help from South Lanarkshire Council. And it is my understanding at the moment that... the policy, each council had to submit the policy in April to the Scottish Government, is that correct? That they had, and each council, South Lanarkshire and North Lanarkshire, both submitted their policy statements, but of course, naturally, both were slightly different, or maybe majorly different, I don't know. So, even from that point of view, we certainly had a meeting and the policy was explained to us through the Seniors Together, and we listened very carefully and made some opinions that we thought were viable at the time. But this is a huge exercise. And even considering that two councils alone have a different idea on their policy, it's going to take a long time this even to evolve. And everyone who's trying to get a consultation or get help in the major areas, especially for the elderly and for the disabled, which is another big part of the community, it's going to really take a lot more, I think, discussion and long term than is doing at the moment. It's not opening up.
I think hopefully, enough. I mean, I can't speak for the government or the health boards, but I'd imagine part of the idea of these partnerships should be that begins a process of discussion and collaboration that has been missing, you know, forever previously, perhaps. And that the idea that these new partnership boards with the carers and befrienders and older people's representation should be an opportunity for everyone to have a say in actually how things are commissioned. The reality may be different, but I think that should be part of a continual process of improvement. But if I can go back to the sort of specificity of what we're looking for, it seems like what we're asking for then is to have older people representatives on every partnership board as a minimum. And then, I mean, John's talked about sort of more as kind of democratic oversight as well. So actually, it's not just about representation on the boards, but actually a voting right, and I as well. And I'm just, can I see, is that shared? So that's, so we're looking for older people to represent on the boards and actually have a voting right that will actually really help sort of shape services. Yes.
Can I just add that there's also some councils where they actually have best practice, and I would say like it's West Lothian. Now it's the same health board as we have in Edinburgh, but they've got theirs actually up and running and going, and it's absolutely, they get a fabulous service out there for older people, keeping them out of hospital. And I think where there's best practice, that should be looked at instead of all this, as I say, with us, it's all the bitty bits where everybody has been asked to submit something, which they're really looking after their own interests, I have to say. A lot of it is just to try and get money out of the council to run their little bit. And in Edinburgh, you find there's a little bit in northeast Edinburgh and bits in southwest Edinburgh, just little bits. And they work quite well, but the rest of the city's just a shambles.
I mean, I think probably the next, I think that's probably quite a kind of useful discussion on the kind of governance and process there, because actually, obviously, you need to get that right before anything else changes. But I'd be quite interested to know, in a more sort of, you know, on health policy, actually, what needs to change? Because we're not just doing this for the sake of governance. We don't want governance. We don't want older people on the board because we want older people on the board. If you want older people on the board, it's to actually change the services. And I'd actually be quite interested in maybe some views on what services we'd like to change. Yes.
I'm changing the subject a bit, but it's all to do with health. It's medication.
Okay.
In the hospitals and at home, the doctors prescribe medication to elderly people, and some people are on about 15, 16 pills a day. And they're prescribed probably 28 days a time. Now, they may be that medication they don't respond well to. So after 3 days, they're on to another medication. So those 25 days of medication, you take it back to the pharmacist and they have to throw it away. If you want to save some money, and if it's possible for the Scottish Parliament to actually bring into effect the way they used to do things, where the pharmacist was actually in control of the medication, if you took it back, he could reuse it. But now, because of health and safety, it's all got to be thrown away, and the vast amount of waste is unbelievable.
Okay. So just an issue about it's kind of addressing the level of medicine waste that sort of as a consequence of people changing
huge.
Their prescription. It's probably. I mean, that's definitely a health related. Can you going back to maybe some more core health and social care areas? Is there anything around what we'd like to see commissioned differently? So, John.
Yeah, can I can only speak from the perspective of Dundee, but Dundee's social work department 5 years ago. In its home care services, 75% were delivered in-house by council employees. Today it's reversed, 25% are delivered in-house, and most of the care services, social care services for older people, are delivered through the private and the voluntary sector. Now that's changed because it's cheaper to do it that way. The council employees get paid the living wage, the people that work in the private and the voluntary sector don't get paid the living wage, don't get travel times. And that's a really big issue. If you're going to deliver top quality care to older people in their own homes, you don't do it in the back of exploiting workers. And I think that has to be a big theme.
In Edinburgh, the actual social that's delivered by the council is very good. Whereas you don't know, because the voluntary sector don't really have to, they don't have to submit whether they're doing a good job or not. I mean, they can just do what they like, and everybody thinks, oh, well, the voluntary, they must be good. That's not necessarily so.
But no, I think, so it comes back to actually, if we're commissioning services, then we're expecting those delivering services to be paid the living wage. You know, because to guarantee that quality of care, that which will ensure that those professions, and not dismissing those who are paid less, but will help safeguard the fact that they will more likely be trained appropriately and been given the space and the time to actually deliver the care that's required to support someone in their home. That seems like quite a clear ask, actually. So all care workers should be paid a living wage to ensure there's kind of higher standards of care delivered in the home.
For the job. If they've paid
absolutely, yeah, absolutely. It'll certainly attract more people. Yes, so gentlemen.
Action on Elder Abuse, but formerly worked in commissioning older people's services for one of the local authorities near to Edinburgh. And having witnessed through my professional life the difficulties in trying to reconcile the ever-increasing demand for people, for older people to have services, and the diminishing financial base from which we are operating, and ending up in situations as just the colleague from Dundee was describing about how the councils, in order to try and make the best value for their money are outsourcing services. And the fact remains is there's not enough money in the care sector to supply the services to the standard that people want and require. When Alec Neil talked about the fact that for 8 years the council tax has been pegged, you can't expect that in that kind of environment you can get the quality of service that people are looking for with no money. And until that situation changes, then unfortunately the situation that people are now going to describe, the kind of horror stories about care at home not being of the standard people want, delivered by services that are paying staff literally as little as they can, for as long as they can, that situation will continue to prevail. You need more money into the sort of, through the exchequer, in order for that to change. And until it changes, and understand that politicians in Scotland are stuck with what they get through the Barnett formula, and that's been cut. But the challenge is, and it may be unpalatable politically, but you're going to have to increase the council tax. Otherwise, this situation is just going to get worse.
For social services, I mean, the majority, I think about 80% of the money that councils get, they get from taxation, general taxation. So actually, it did go up by 3%. Our council tax would have gone up 3% every year if they hadn't added, they didn't get that money from the council. And anyway, most of the money from council tax, I mean, about a quarter of it goes into the pensions of the people that work in the authority. So, I mean, I think the council has got to look at what they pay people, especially a lot of the people at the top, etc., and about the handouts they give them when they retire or they leave because there's been some sort of discrepancies going on. There's lots and lots of ways that the council could actually save money without dismissing staff, etc. So, I mean, the council tax itself, you'd have to put it up. If we hadn't had council tax freeze, what in the heck council tax would we be paying now? And Edinburgh Council actually doubled the tax of the council tax in the first 7 years of the Scottish Parliament. Not 60%, doubled it. And even the way that they've actually sort of given council tax, you get people in a deprived area, like Newhurst, deprived area, they are paying the top council band, which is H, the same as J.K. Rowling, somewhere in the same area of Edinburgh West.
Okay, I think there's probably a middle ground that we could actually perhaps agree on. I think the point is actually, I think it's a good point actually. We can call for a lot of things, but actually there is a limited budget. And if I just finish, finish this point, but actually perhaps we can talk about just generally the need for increased taxation. Maybe we don't want to specify the particular tax vehicle, but need for actually, you know, increased taxation to pay for our demands or our calls for a living wage for care workers. Yes.
Getting back to my original point, this gentleman made a very valid point regarding the lack of cash. And this gentleman has made even a better point regarding the lack of cash. Now, what I was attempting to do earlier was to point to a possible source of cash. That is, the large number of tourists that come to Scotland. Now, in America, I gather they pay a hotel room tax of 6% on their rooms. Now, as I understand it, they come to all these thousands of people who come to Scotland pay nothing in terms of room tax, but perhaps they pay some other kind of tax, I'm not sure. But having said that, if we're looking for cash, then that is one possible source that can be looked at. It has been raised before in the past, but it's never come off. But they're looking for cash, we don't have enough. There's one possible source of some cash.
Mm-hmm. Eleanor.
Yes, I think we need to be careful where what we're falling into here. Are we beginning to say, look, sorry, old folk, we can't afford you? Yes, no. You know, there's been times in the past when that has been actually said in Westminster. It's listed in Hansard as parts of the contributions made by MPs. You know, we can't afford you, unsustainable, and so on and so forth. But before getting back to that, I would just like to argue that the standard of services that should be available for older people, the whole range of services, and the training of the staff so that they can deliver a good quality of service, could easily be underpinned by the current human rights legislation, which is there. We have all agreed it, and that should be the basis. That should be the standard at first, and then we can build on it. And the staff providing these services, having a decent living wage, there is money available for it. Yes, some people don't pay their taxes. Some firms don't pay their taxes. You know, there are all sorts of political ways in which the monies could be gained to have a decent service, have decent services for older people. We cannot begin to say you're not really as much a human being as any as other groups, and therefore, you know, the services and your needs cannot be met. These human rights, the human needs have been established, and we must find the money. There are ways of doing it. And, you know, you get into the realms of politics. And now, I'm sorry, but that's what it is. Either that, or you do say to us, we can't afford you. What are you going to choose? SOPA has only got one route it can go down if it's going to be sustained as a credible older people's organisation, and that is to fight for us.
Yeah. So I think what you're saying, so basically we need human rights to underpin our approach to care and care standards
absolutely.
In Scotland.
Absolutely.
That may or may not, but it may require an increase in the general level of taxation to pay for that. There are a number of means that could sort of deliver that. We're not prescribing those as such, but it's the approach to human rights and values and care standards is the most important thing.
Money for the banks.
Okay, so we've got an issue around, we've got representation on the panels, and older people's ideally voting representation on each of the panels. We're looking at, you know, human rights, which values underpinning our approach to care, and living wage for all care staff as part of that, that may be addressed through increasing general taxation. Are there any other points before I'd like to take the opportunity to go into money in a minute, but sort of take this woman first and then back to you, John, and then we'll
Leslie Carkery from Action on Elder Abuse. I've heard a few concerns from older people who are being discharged from hospital and waiting to go back to their own home, where in a lot of hospitals, because of the discharge procedure, they're maybe being sent to the discharge lounge. They're getting woken up at 6 a.m. to fit in with the hospital's procedures because it works easier for them. They can be sitting in the discharge lounge for up to 6 hours at a time. And we've heard of a lot of cases where single older people have been sitting there all day. By the time they go home, particularly older people who live on their own, they're so exhausted, they don't have the energy to go out and buy the basic necessities that they need. So I've heard of quite a few local examples of voluntary sector agencies who put together sort of basic rations, and they'll give that to the older person. But I mean, it's not really sustainable, and it's only happening in certain parts of the country. But I think that's an example of something that it doesn't necessarily need more funding. It's just a rethink about the way that older people are discharged, and don't always think, well, that's an older person, you don't need to worry about rushing home for work or family. Think, well, actually, this person should be a higher priority because they're going home on their own and they've got no one else to help with these basic needs. And I think sometimes there's more of a focus on the health needs are the priority, but when you think of these little things, they're just as important for older people.
At the end of that appointment, there's a sort of person checkup, you know, how are you getting home? What are you doing? Is there anybody else there? What have you got prepared? You know, a simple... You don't want to be presumptuous and suggest that someone needs, but actually just that 2 minutes almost at the end of it, and if there aren't provisions in place, then they can be directed towards someone. The hospital can then sort of help them get home and help. Or
I think it's just so important not to forget that those things are just as important as health needs for a lot of older people.
That seems fairly sensible and obvious, actually. I think there's no disagreement on that. So yes, okay. So it's just having the, you know, hospital appointments to be as timely as possible to ensure older people are able to get in and out as quickly as possible, because we don't, so they're not waiting around hospital corridors all day.
And that is actually quite acceptable to wake someone up at 6 a.m. Yes, I mean, just because it suits the staff better. They might actually prefer to sleep a bit longer because they're going to have to sit in a discharge lounge all day. So just to be a bit more person centred, I suppose.
Yeah, that seems so. Okay. Health and social care was still the bigger priority. So I do want to spend a couple more minutes on this before we move on to kind of money matters. John, I don't know if you had another
Yeah, I was just, I mean, I take entirely the point that we're not blaming the councils here, because they don't have the budgets and the money isn't in the system to pay for the kind of service we need. But what you don't get from either the council officials or the councillors themselves is any public acknowledgement that this is the case. They try to tell us we're getting the best possible deal that's available, that everything in the garden is rosy, and it isn't. behind the scenes, yep. things are getting very, very bad indeed. Yep. We want the councils and the elected officials to publicly acknowledge that they haven't got the money instead of trying to sell this as a great thing, because it's not a great thing. Just be honest about it. Older people are no stupid. They know when they're getting a raw deal.
Of best practice.
Yes.
I mean, West Lothian are running one. I mean, they've got council budget cuts as well. But actually, they have a REACT team and they have a geriatrician appointed with the change fund. And she has actually integrated all this, the GPs, the physios, the occupational therapists, the nursing staff, the social works department. And when there's a crisis comes up with an older person, the team actually moves right in, the doctor, the lot, into the house to see exactly what their needs are or whether they need to go to back into St. John's. And even there, there's a team called REACT, and it really works extremely well. And I only got to know about that because of people that lived in West Lothian. It wasn't as if I was snooping around trying to find out what was going on. But when you started to hear the services that they were getting, you sort of thought, well, that's great. You know, and yet they must have cut budgets as well. So I really think it's down to incompetence on the part of our local authority of not being able to get something in place.
You know, different areas have different people at different points in their career, and actually I think we'll probably focus on the positive. Actually, maybe what we take from that is where there are examples of best practices. How are they communicated and shared across the other partnerships? Because I don't know if that's the responsibility of the Joint Improvement Team. I'm not sure exactly what the mechanisms
do with what they got in the change fund. I'm still trying to find out where that money went, and they must have got a good pile of money, more than West Lothian.
Yeah. Well, but if we could take as a kind of action from that, it's more about where we see West Lothian as an example of really good practice, then that's where other partnerships should be going, you know. Where perhaps it's shadowing the people on this new board, perhaps it's them coming to help them commission services, but maybe the role of the Joint Improvement Team to pull that together and actually prepare new guidance on how commissioning services should go. But there must be some mechanisms where we could actually use that example. I'm sure others around the country.
Private areas, but also in fairly affluent areas as well. It seems to be that it's common. Absolutely great round.
Great. Okay.
So this is a question, not a statement. I'm just wondering how enthusiastic in reality your council and other councils are about this whole process of integrating healthcare and social services. Are they really behind this, or are they just putting on a cosmetic operation?
The group that I'm on is more of a talking shop than getting things done.
That's my impression, I'm afraid, to some extent, yeah.
I think we've done quite well. We've actually got quite a number clear. We've talked about the sort of governance and older people's representation. So, Cathy, will you really help me with remembering?
Yeah, I'll just go over where we are before we go on to the next thing. Okay, so at the beginning we had the Greens said there was too much input from across the third sector, that it was difficult to integrate it all, that it was difficult to have specific powers and you were only asked to comment. There wasn't any responsibility on budgets. The health boards and the local authorities had ownership of the budgets. So there was no vote for that. It wasn't a partnership. Older people didn't feel that they had any empowerment. Older people wanted to have representation with voting rights. Spoken quite a bit at looking at best practice. West Lothian's been brought up a couple of times, and the Joint Improvement Team commissioning guidance on best practice. That lady over there spoke about wasting money on medication, look at recycling it, reusing it. Care services, a lot about that, exploitation of workers, pay them the living wage when commissioning services to get a quality service, and there isn't enough money in councils to provide care at home. You had to consider a number of things. Increasing council tax was one. Other ways of saving money, the man talked over there about a room tax or just general increased taxation. In the care of the lady in the white jacket, that care of older people should be underpinned by human rights legislation around care standards, living wage values. We must find the money from somewhere, and discharge procedures can be too long for single older people. There should be some sort of checklist and signposting to organisations, and then public acknowledgement by councils about the financial difficulty they have in meeting some of the services, and that the representation generally by older people is really just a talking shop.
Great, thanks Cathy. So we've got 16 minutes left for the second. I think it was important to spend more time on that one because that was a clear interest and priority of everyone here.
Might. It's not room tax I'm talking about, it's hotel room tax I'm talking about. There's quite a big difference in that. It's hotels.
Yeah. I knew what I meant.
So, I think it's important.
The second item, second priority area we decided was retirement, pension and money matters. Something I'm actually a little less versed in than health and social care. So actually I'll probably lead less, and I'd be quite interested initially what are your concerns around this area, particularly those who put their hands up for that. I know there are fewer, but those who put their hands up on that subject matter, what are your concerns around retirement, pension and money matters? Yes.
Well, I think if we start with this infamous new benefit that's going to be introduced next year, new pension, flat rate right. pension. It was introduced to the House of Parliament as it was going to be a universal, equally distributed through all the nation, all the pensioners would get them. It's turned out to be an utter disaster, and I've not got it here with me, but I've got the figures that 73% of the people that are about to become pensioners or our pensioners now will not benefit from that. They will not get it depends which government you're listening to. One says the rate will be 151, the Scottish government says it'll be 161. But that isn't the point. The attempt to equal out and the pension has been an utter failure. So we're going to, all these problems that folk were, the politicians said that they were going to get, they've been told the lie and they're going to have to suffer. Now, how do you deal with that when there's all the other pressures on the previous issue about care? Yeah. And every senior politician in every party has said, we know there's going to be more pensioners, they're going to live longer, etc., etc., and we'll have to do something really important and special to deal with that. They've all said that, and none of them have brought even a hint of what they're going to do.
So is it the... Because one of the questions that came up in the session this morning was about the women of a certain age who are going to miss out. And I don't. It doesn't seem like you're talking about that one specifically, but more generally, there's an issue around the kind of gap in pension.
The women are particularly the worst affected by that.
So it's,
and I mean, I know individual pensioners that their the woman's pension's based on the husband.
So it sounds like that. Is that
and
what
she only gets 66?
So is that then looking at sort of you basically the government, the UK government? To actually fill that gap that they've created between what women in particular and maybe others are going to have, what they expected in their pension and what they're going to receive in their pension. So, yes.
This business of equality for women and pensions doesn't just for the group that are retiring now. All the women born before 1953, now if you were a widow, you did get your husband's state pension when he died, but if you were a single person, you didn't. So there was lots of single women who had taken time off to look after children, look after parents, so they didn't have the full number of stamps to get a full pension. So lots of these women are really badly, I mean, they've got pensions of below £100 a week. because this was brought up at our ACFA meetings as well, once when we were doing about poverty and old age. So, I mean, so the women born before 1953, again, have been very unfairly treated, especially if they weren't married on a married basis. So if they were had a husband, fine. But if you were single, no, you didn't. So that was inequality there. So, I mean, that's something, but to tell you the truth, you'll not get any joy from Ros Altman, who's the pensions minister.
I'm sure everybody else did. Ros Altman, the new pensions minister, said, you know, she'd love to help women, but she has no money and she can't.
She said, you're just unfortunate to be born in that age.
Okay, I was spinning that movie. Sorry,
Jane. Just a wee point to add to what Ken was saying. I mean, it is going to be a two-tier pension scheme. And pensioners of my age and a bit younger, lots of them think they're going to be getting this 151 or whatever. And that's a worry because, you know, that looks as if, you know, they've been promised that. And that's not the case.
So, I mean, so it's notwithstanding the comments from the pensions minister saying that there's no chance, so it sounds like a... Because actually, just because you're said no, told no, doesn't mean you shouldn't ask. You know, and actually, it sounds like the kind of the gap that women in particular, and maybe others now approaching pension age, between the expectation and reality is something that seems to want to focus on.
I mean, even people that are not collecting, younger women, they haven't cottoned on to the fact that they've got to have all the stamps right through to get that pension. So if they take time off just now, to look after children or look after older parents or somebody who's got physical needs, etc., then they won't have all the full stamps and they're just going to be in exactly the same boat. Yeah. And they haven't actually, the younger generation haven't appreciated that.
Yeah, sorry, gentlemen, and then yourself.
Last year at this committee I was on, we discussed pension and we agreed then unanimously that the state pension should be no less than above the poverty level. Gender didn't come into it. Every pensioner should have a pension better than the poverty level. We've got 1.6 million pensioners in the UK that live in poverty. That's just not acceptable. Yeah. And we've got another 1.1 million who are barely above the poverty level. So we shouldn't be messing about with gender issues and all the rest of it. A basic state pension, which is above the poverty level.
I think there's something quite simple and clear about that policy, actually, personally. But, I mean, I'm happy. Does that feel that so we're a state pension that is no lower than what we'd consider the poverty line?
I think we need to be positive about it.
Yeah, I mean, we can turn that around its head.
Completely preventive and in line with human rights, that is. Because if you want to prevent people going to hospital and being ill, give them more than poverty income to live on. If you don't do that, then you are going to have more people who are dependent, more people who have got physical and mental illnesses. And it's idiotic to create a situation where people are in desperate situation.
Yeah. So is anyone else who hasn't commented who wants to come in?
Comments usually are. But I have for quite a long time had a big of a puzzle in my mind about why I pay tax on my pension. Somebody will probably tell me why, but it seems extraordinary to me that I've worked quite a lot of my life, not as hard as I could have done, but I have worked, and I have, I think, justified the award of a state pension. I'm puzzled to know why I still pay tax on a money which I've already earned and paid tax on, if you see what I mean. Does that make sense at all to you? Yeah, good.
Yeah, I don't have an answer for that. I mean, the answer is it's a source of revenue for the government. That's obviously the reason it is. And obviously, there previously was a differential in the tax allowance between working and non-working population. But as the tax allowance has increased, previously older people had £10,500 tax free and working age population had about six or seven, and as the working age population tax allowance has increased up to 10.5, the older people's one has frozen, so there's an equality in the tax allowance, which doesn't, I think, probably give older people, working age people, have the opportunity to increase their income for other jobs. That's not the case for older people. people. So I don't have a solution, but I can understand your point. Sorry,
it was just a quite the this is for covering the whole of the UK. The new official figures show that 1.2 million people will obtain the flat rate pension. Only 80,000 women will receive the full amount. Sorry.
Okay. I think that just strengthens what we said. So there's clearly women are going to be the kind of most hit by this new pension. But since the point you made, sorry, forgot your name. But actually, that pension, at least in line with what we consider the poverty line, would be a way to negate a lot of the complexity, which a lot of people aren't understanding. This topic was with retirement pension and money matters, and I think Jeanette talked about the fact it was maybe like also fuel or funeral plans. And I just wonder, we've got 6 minutes left, are there any other comments around maybe some other areas that connected with money on energy prices or funerals that we'd like to just have a quick discussion around, or still on pensions? Sorry, yes.
Can I just name check? I'm John Burrell. I'm the person that was named by the Minister this morning, charged with reviewing the whole question of funeral costs and funeral poverty. I don't want to take up time at this meeting, but I would be happy to hear from anybody who has particular issues or suggestions or comments around the cost of funerals and the whole area of funeral poverty. If you catch me at the end, I'll give you a card and you can get in touch with me.
That's great. Thanks very much, John. That probably negates a conversation on funeral plans to some degree. So John. Okay.
Issue in Dundee, the local crematorium in Dundee is run by Dignity PLC, who are a big operator right across the UK. I don't know how many crematoriums and graveyards they own, but they charge the highest cremation fees anywhere in Scotland. There's a patchwork of people. Some crematoria are local authority owned, some are private sector owned. They charge whatever prices they like. There doesn't seem to be any kind of code, no kind of control over it, and somebody's got to come up with an idea of regulating the funeral industry. So is it everybody's made to reach a certain standard, I think, in the future. Because they're profiteering at the moment. Absolutely profiteering.
Sorry, gentlemen.
John, just another good example of the market being where services are now being provided and by whom. It's the same with the care services. My earlier remarks are also about the fact that you have to outsource to organisations who are in it for profit. And as soon as you make care with a profit motive, you end up with the kind of economics that we've got. And I go back to my point, if you flatline the council tax, notwithstanding what you said about some of the economics in Edinburgh, the fact remains, if you flatline it for 8 years, do the maths. You end up with what we've got. The demographic time bomb, we knew, and I knew 15 years ago, what the older people's population was going to be. Yep. And I worked in West Lothian, and we actually did take steps. But in order to make it happen, we had to spread the money as thin as we could. And we were purchasing care-at-home services for less than £10 an hour. Can you tell me that you can give a quality service at that kind of economic... But that's what we had to do in order to give the 2,000 people who required the service at all. Yeah. And if Edinburgh are cutting back and other councils are cutting back, that is why. You can't get away from it. It's economics. And as long as you make the profit element to companies to provide services, you'll end up with the situation we've got now. It will get worse before it gets better. We need to pay more money, more tax, and until we do that and grasp that economic fact, the situation will continue to get worse.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's kind of probably covered that point. We've got a couple of just last comments, really, before we'll kind of Cathy will just quickly run through what we've discussed in this kind of quite short session.
I agree with that. There's been a lot of comments about sort of supply of funds to do services, but the point that's been made about quality is an independent point. You know, quality is important anyway. If you reduce the unit cost down to a level where the service isn't what people want, all the money's wasted.
I think that's one of the points Eleanor was making really earlier.
Maybe we need to treat the quality and judgment of the quality as a separate thing, and something that may be the focus for older people's involvement in the boards and things is to have an independent voice on that quality.
Yeah, no, I think that's part. I suppose the point I think was trying to be made was the money was a prerequisite to get some of the quality, but what Eleanor was talking about is underpinned by human rights, which again is all of a double guarantee. If we've got the appropriate resources, we've got certain values in which we'll design services by, that collectively should hope, we'd expect to actually deliver a care service that treats people with dignity. and keeps them out of hospital and residential care.
But it doesn't follow, does it? Unless somebody's still watching the quality.
Yes, yeah, no, I mean, that has to be kind of maintained continually. I still don't have any final points, I'll just have Cathy, if you're able to kind of just...
And then we need to decide the two things that we're going to forward to the discussion for each of the topics. So pensions and money, the gentleman over there said 73% would not benefit from the new pension, £151, which is a two-tier pension, that's a higher. Some women will be most affected if they haven't paid their full national insurance contributions and had time off. Some single women born before 1953 would get a much reduced pension, so that's inequality and discrimination against female gender. Every basic pension should be above the poverty line, it's just basic human rights. Why do older people have to pay a tax on pension when they've already paid tax on their salary? Funeral costs, private crematorium should be regulated for the costs, and the gentleman at the top says the demographic time bomb for older people's care services, more money, more tax, or things will get worse, and it's the quality that's essential.
Okay, thank you. Kath, can we go back to the first page and we'll just quickly agree the 2 points on health and social care, then the money map. I think for me, I'm going to take my prerogative as kind of facilitator here and just hopefully no one agree with me, was the main ones were around the governance and actually the older people's representation, voting representation on the panel. I think that was, so voting representation on the partnerships was central. And the second one was... It was about the kind of the living wage and the care standards and ensuring that underpinned the approach to care services. That I think, are we agreed on those two? Fantastic. Yeah. And when it comes to the money matters one, the 2 points were abolishing that inequity between men and women and the women who particularly are coming to retire right now, and they should be getting what they were expecting in their pensions, not what they're now getting. They're getting. And a second point, the point was really about the pension being above the poverty line. That was our solution to that. Sorry, so the point was, and do we have a second core point on that, or is it maybe more just the Cabinet Secretary's commission that John is now looking at? Is that our area around actual kind of need fairness in the market around funeral plans? Yeah? Super. Okay, thank you all very much for contributing. I think we're back downstairs.